Over the last few years, there's been a trend of simplification in desktop software. Ricardo Mori calls this the iOSification of macOS. And just a few days ago, Apple announced Logic and Final Cut Pro for iPadOS. So you can see macOS, iOS, and iPadOS are all slowly moving closer and closer together. But this isn't necessarily a good thing. Sure, it might be good for developers who can code their apps to be slightly more similar, but it's really bad for power users. Jeff Chaus, writing about a Shopify dashboard redesign where they added more white space and made icons slightly bigger, wrote, "People who live in some key apps want information density. White space is much less important when you're intimately familiar with an app." And this got me thinking, what does it mean to have a desktop application? What does it mean to design complex apps for desktop users? So in this video, I'm going to talk you through a set of principles I found to make this easier. And before we get into it, just to say, hey, I'm Bhavan. I'm a design educator who teaches people how to become better designers. If you're new here, make sure you hit subscribe so you don't miss any new videos. So before we jump into the principles for making great complex desktop apps, I think it's worth defining what a complex desktop application is. So these are defined by being used by a very specific type of person. So not a generalist, but someone who is there to do a specific job. Because of the nature of that job or of those complicated functions they have to carry out, this work is most likely to be done on a computer or on a laptop device, which therefore means it will be done with a pointer, so a trackpad or a mouse, which allows for fine precision control of interface elements. So this might go against what you consider good user experience, but think about a flight console. So a flight console is an example of an interface in the real world. And it's so incredibly complicated. Just looking at a photo of one of these makes my brain kind of go, wow. There are so many toggles and switches and dials and different things that you can control. But a pilot, who is the specific user that this interface was designed for, is totally in control. The pilot requires access to all of these things at once and is intimately familiar with all of it and knows how to use it effectively. So I've recently been working with a life sciences company. I can't talk too much about the work I'm doing for them. And we're designing some desktop software tools to allow really specialized users that, you know, people doing things you probably won't know that anyone would be doing to do really specialized tasks. Usually they're in a lab and they've got really giant monitors. So in doing this, I thought, hey, what are the principles to create the best software for them? So here's what I found. So the first set of principles come from Mathieu Tozier's code along session at WWDC 21. So he ran a session on how to create a macOS app to tend your garden and to keep track of what plants are growing in what spaces, to remind you to water them, to tell you how long they take to mature, and so on. And when walking through how to code this app, he demonstrated four design principles, which I think not only apply to any native macOS app, but really apply to any complex desktop app. And those principles are, firstly, flexibility, which means the interface should be flexible depending on how the user wants to use it. This means it should be size, users should be able to toggle on columns and sidebars or adjust how much width they take up. And it even means flexibility to do with input device. So if a user wants to use a trackpad or a pointer or one of those kind of spear inputs, they should be able to do so and the interface should still work with it. Secondly is familiarity. So the app should be familiar to any user straight away by using common OS design language patterns. So for macOS, that means having a menu bar at the top, as well as navigation and hierarchy along with the sidebar and the main content right in the center of the window. Now, this idea of familiarity and working to a common design language isn't just for macOS or operating systems. Think about Adobe Creative Cloud. Every app does something completely different. You might be editing videos or creating sound design or manipulating vector graphics, but the layout of tools and the way the panels interact and can be repositioned is exactly the same in all Creative Cloud apps. The third principle is expansiveness. And this means that the interface should work on a very large display or on multiple displays. This means that lots of information can be shown without having to be hidden away and having to be found by digging down through lots of different menus. I think this is really a big difference from mobile design, where you want to show as little to a user as possible, you know what their main task on any screen is, so you're guiding them through a series of CTAs. And to be honest, this is the same on web design as well. For marketing websites or tools for the general purpose user, they should only really be doing one thing per screen. But for desktop apps, this is really bad because we don't know what a user is doing at any one time, and they're the master of their own workflow, so they'll be able to decide what is useful to them. The fourth principle is precision. So everything in the interface should have narrow margins and small amounts of white space to allow for high density of information and fine control. This just allows you to pack in more information and again is designed to be used with a cursor. So these were the first four principles from Mathieu Tozier's session. I also found a set of tactics from the Nielsen Norman Group, which is this incredible UX consultancy. They actually list 8 tactics to make it easier to design desktop apps, but there's a lot of overlap. So you can go and read the full list, but here are the 4 I think are the most important. Firstly, promote learning by doing. So this is so obvious in apps like Premiere Pro, where you've got a panel which shows what's going on, or a live preview section in apps like Photoshop, when you're trying out different effects, just to make sure you know what's going to happen when you press OK. This really allows users to figure out what they're doing by themselves and encourages learning by experimentation. Secondly, give contextual help. You see this in apps like Ableton, which have a dedicated space in the bottom left to tell you what each tool does or what each part of the interface is for as you move your cursor over it. So contextual help, really important. The third tactic is provide flexible pathways to allow a user to reach a goal. This is so dissimilar to widely held UX practices, which say there should be one way of doing everything and there should be a clear flow through a journey. With desktop apps and with these kind of complex pieces of software for more specialist users, it's really important to allow people lots of different ways to get to a goal. And again, that company I'm working on where we're doing lots of setup flows for different scientific experiments in a lab, this is so important. You need to be able to go back and change things and update things. That was basically the biggest complaint they had with pre-existing software. There was no way to go back without having to restart the entire experiment. The fourth tactic is to reduce clutter without reducing complexity. So this basically means use progressive disclosure. Have ways to show and hide different elements or hide panels, but don't mandate that a user doesn't have to see them. Give them the option of hiding things, but make sure that they can always turn them back on if they need. Anyway, those were 8 principles and tactics for designing desktop applications. I hope you found this useful. Please do hit the like button below. It really helps me out as I'm trying to grow the channel. It's really important to sweat the small stuff. I think lots of designers miss details like this, and it is really what takes our interface designs to the next level. That's all from me now. Make sure you hit subscribe so you don't miss the next video, and I'll see you on the next one. Cheers.